A VPN, or virtual private network, provides a way to send sensitive information over the public internet. You've probably seen ads for them in all sorts of websites, apps, yes, and even YouTube videos. Well, let me put your mind at ease. I'm not trying to sell you one. That said, what about the claim that they protect your privacy? Do they really? Or could they actually make the situation worse? Let's take a look at VPNs and see what they are, what threats they're trying to guard against, and the different types of VPNs that exist out there, and ultimately, whether they deliver what they claim in terms of protecting your privacy, or are they the proverbial wolf in sheep's clothing? Okay, let's take a look at what VPNs are and what kinds of threats we're trying to guard against. We'll take a scenario where we've got this guy right here who wants to send information to a website over here, and he's going to send maybe a credit card number, a social security number, some other kind of form of ID, something that's sensitive, something that might be valuable like intellectual property. But the problem is, it's going out over a public network. This is like speaking it out into a public space. Who is listening? And we don't know exactly. In fact, there could be a number of people listening. There are tools that allow people to eavesdrop on other conversations that go over the internet. And that could happen as it's going over the internet. It could also happen right here. In an attack known as an evil twin, we have, if this person, let's say, is at a coffee shop or a hotel where they're using the local Wi-Fi, it's not their own home Wi-Fi, well, someone might set up an evil twin Wi-Fi that goes by the same name, but it doesn't go to what you think it's going to this particular attacker. So they could then see all of your packets that are going before they even get onto the internet. So the information that this guy is wanting to send over here could have already been looked at by a number of different people, which is not the idea if you're trying to protect sensitive stuff like this. So what are we supposed to do about that? Well, one solution is a VPN. So a typical VPN, if you're going to get one for your own personal use, is basically going to set up a connection between you and the website you're trying to go to. And I'm drawing these as pipes to visualize that because that's sort of how we think about this. What's happened is you've installed some client software, usually on your system, or it could be that you're going through a website, but we'll assume that the case where you installed some client software on your system. And everything that's going to go to the network doesn't go directly to the internet. It goes, in fact, first gets encrypted, then it gets sent down to your VPN provider. The VPN provider then decrypts the information, figures out where it's supposed to go to, and then encrypts it again and sends it over here. Now, what's the value of that? Well, among a number of different things, this website may, in fact, in some cases, this is desirable. You don't want the website to actually know who you are. You want to be able to go there anonymously. Now, if you're sending this information, you've already blown that case away. But sometimes maybe you live in a country where free speech is not particularly valued and you need to be able to get to certain information. You might also want to hide your location, because there may be blocks for certain types of things. So if you're not coming from a particular space, then you might get blocked. Well, what happens is this website only sees the VPN provider, and the user, only their system only sees the VPN provider. And the ISP and the eavesdropper and the evil twin only see that you have encrypted traffic going to this VPN. They don't know where it goes beyond that. The ISP can't be violating your privacy, it would seem in this case, because all they know is you're just sending a lot of traffic to this particular address, and they can't even see what the traffic is. So by encrypting the information first, then decrypting it, then encrypting it again and decrypting it again, and then doing the same thing as it traverses back the other way, now we have a way where each side of the equation is limited in terms of what it can see. And this is where some of these privacy protections, and in some cases, security protections, can come from. Okay, we just took a look at what a VPN is. Now, we talked a little bit about what some of the threats are, but let's drill into that a little bit more because it might not always be obvious. Bob Dylan has a song that says, "You've got to serve somebody." Well, I'm going to say, "You've got to trust somebody." No matter what you do, you're going to have to end up putting trust somewhere. And VPNs are essentially a way of transferring trust. So let's take a look at what the different VPN options are and what it is that you're trusting in each one of those cases. So in the first case, let's assume we have no VPN. So none. Then who are we trusting in that case? Well, we're basically trusting your ISP, that they're not going to leak the information because they're seeing all of your traffic as it's leaving, and that they're not going to keep that themselves or sell it to someone or give that information up. Or you're having to trust also, I shouldn't say or, but also the internet and all the people that might be out there that might see the packets that are going around. So in that case, you're having to put a lot of trust in some players that in some cases you have no relationship with at all. Another type of VPN that I really didn't describe in this example, but I'll do a little more later, is a corporate VPN. So maybe your company wants to let you work from home or for some remote location. And in that case, they want to provide a secure tunnel, a pipe between your system and their system. So something that's going to go directly. Now, in that case, you're obviously entrusting your employer, because they're the ones being the VPN provider in that case. They may not be interested in your privacy, they're interested in their security, and those two are not the same thing. Another type of VPN, which is the one that I illustrated here, which is what most people tend to think about when they're thinking about VPNs and the ones that you see all the ads for, is a third-party VPN. And in this case, a third-party VPN is basically you're having to trust the provider of that VPN. So in this case, the VPN service provider would be here. Since the information is coming in, it's encrypted here, so I'm not having to trust these folks, but I am having to trust this one because they have now decrypted the traffic. They're going to see where all of my traffic is going, the IP addresses and things like that, the frequency of it, all of that, whereas my ISP would just see I'm sending everything to this place. In this case, it's going to see all of the information because it's going to decrypt it. It's going to have it in the clear when it's right here. So it could see any of that stuff and examine it, and then it encrypts it as it sends it on. So now that means all of my trust is here in this case. How trustworthy is that organization? Well, we hope it is, but we know not all of them are. In some cases, they might be trustworthy, they might intend to do the right things, but there are things that they can, like if you're getting a free VPN, look, the old saying is if you're not paying for it, you're not the customer, you're the product. So if you're the product, you're not paying for a free VPN, how could you be a product? Well, they might be using your data and selling it to someone else. So they're monetizing your data, which means your privacy may not be their first priority. Another case is this site could get hacked. So even though they don't mean to do anything wrong, if a bad guy hacks into their site, now they have access to your records and all of your traffic. And another case is that law enforcement, or through a court order, may compel this VPN provider to hand over your records if they think there's been a crime. So all of this depends on how much you trust this VPN provider. That's why some of these are in different legal jurisdictions in order to get around some of the, you know, hey, we don't want to respond to your legal requirements for our particular service. But there's not always a lot known about who these organizations are. But the point is, we're putting all of our trust. We've transferred our trust from the internet to this VPN provider. Now, the other thing that you could do if you're really sensitive about privacy is you could do a bring your own VPN. In this case, you're going to provide your own infrastructure. You're going to provide your own server. You're going to provide your own client. So maybe if I'm coming in from another place, another location, I tunnel into my VPN server, and then it goes out to wherever it is I want it to go. So I could do that as well. But in this case, I'm putting all the trust in myself, which you might say, well, if you're really sensitive about privacy, that's who you ought to be trusting. But the other part is you're still trusting something else. You're trusting the software that you're using to run that VPN. So you're going to download that. It might be open source stuff, and you might say, well, I think that's trustworthy. But the point is, you're still trusting something else. So you're either trusting the internet, your ISP, your employer, your VPN provider, or the provider of the software. But you got to trust somebody. Okay, so there is another look at the threats. And we've also looked at the types here now. But now let's talk about the privacy protections and what they do and what they don't do. Well, in particular, I'm going to focus on this one, these third-party VPNs, since that's what most people are thinking about. The employer VPN, as I already said, is really not designed to protect your privacy. It's designed to protect the company's security. Now, they may have a thing called a split tunnel where some of your information goes directly to the internet and some of it goes to the company network. That's another way of doing that. But in no case is it really protecting your privacy, I don't think. However, these third-party VPNs, let's take a look at some of the pros and cons of these. So one of the pros that's here is that it hides your IP. So if you look back over here, remember the website doesn't see what your source IP address is. It doesn't even know your exact location. In fact, it's a way to make it look like you're somewhere else because the VPN, wherever that server is, that's the ID, that's the IP address, that's the location that's going to be surfaced. And again, the ISP doesn't see this either because all it sees is that you're going to that place. Another thing, as I said, is hiding your location. And another thing is it's hiding your data. So because this information is encrypted as it's going down to the VPN provider, we call this a tunnel. In this tunnel, the data is encrypted. So anyone that sees this just sees encrypted data. And the same thing over here. So those are the pros for this. Now, how about some of the cons? Because everything's got pros and cons, it seems. First of all, there's this belief that a VPN gives you anonymity. Well, yeah, kind of, but not full anonymity. Because after all, the VPN provider sees all. They see all of your traffic coming in, all of your traffic going out. They're seeing your IP address, your location, and your data. So it's anonymous from the standpoint maybe of some of these other actors, but the VPN provider now sees all of that. Also, it doesn't stop tracking cookies and browser fingerprinting and things like that, which a website might do. So, and especially if you've logged into the website, well, then obviously it knows who you are, so that's not going to be anonymous. So some people have a naive notion that if I'm going through a VPN, I'm anonymous. Well, you may or may not be. It depends on some of these other aspects that might still be violating some of your privacy. And as I mentioned, if you're logged in, then you're not going to be able to guard against that. And then finally, the last one is it adds some latency. Latency meaning it adds some delay because I've got to encrypt my data. Then I have to send it to a third party, which is going to decrypt it, who is then going to encrypt it again. And then it's going to get decrypted over here. So it's going through a third party with multiple encrypts and decrypts. All of these things, again, are potentially slowing the system down. Typically, one of these type of VPNs will run slower than you would get if you just went directly. But if you just went directly, you might not have the protections you want. So again, the bottom line is you're trusting this, and is that where you want to trust? Not all VPNs are created equal. In fact, given that most websites these days implement encryption automatically, some might argue that the need for a VPN is not as critical as it once was. But if a VPN is well implemented, it can improve security and protect privacy. If not, it could actually make matters worse by handing over your data directly to a bad actor. In some countries where free speech is not protected, they may be the only option to counteract censorship, as I experienced firsthand when I was living overseas. But these countries might also legally compel providers to reveal your records. A VPN can't stop malware, despite what some ads claim, and they aren't a guarantee of privacy. But a good VPN can, in the right hands, be an excellent tool, or in the wrong hands, an expensive fraud.